It's the Back in Blue video podcast.
Coming up on the show today in Jay's Trending, we cover the bullpen's early struggles, initial thoughts on Colby Rasmus and Brett Laurie's play, also a recap of the Jays' first week at home, and Nick had the chance to chat with Lloyd Moseby. All that and more coming up next on Back in Blue. Back in Blue 15's here, baby. Let's do this. Ready to go?
You know I am. How you feeling?
Feel great, man. Jays are back in town.
That's right.
Can't complain.
Definitely not. Blue Jays baseball, Bib 15. It's going quick. Get some action this week?
A lot of action. I made it up to four games.
Four games.
Yeah,
it's wild.
Beauty. Home opener. Oh, the whole Boston series. A little bit of the Orioles. It was
nice.
Great. Jays are back. I'm excited. Let's get the show kicked off. Jays Trending. First up, bullpen woes.
That's right. Bullpen woes. That's a good way to explain it.
Yep.
Four blown saves, four losses. It's disappointing. I guess you could say they're on pace for 81 blown saves this year.
Yeah.
If you want to get out of control.
Yep.
I don't know. Like it's definitely frustrating as a fan to see. I came out somewhere. It's definitely frustrating as a fan to see Santos come out and have a couple blown saves there in his first two opportunities.
It's rough, man.
Yeah.
It's
but
rough.
I think he's going to be okay. He came through in his third opportunity with two guys on scoring position.
Mm-hmm.
Shut down the Red Sox there, so
yep.
Showed some poise.
Yep.
And unfortunately, Darren Oliver and Jansen both picked up a couple blown saves too.
Yeah, yeah. The Oliver game was that was against the Orioles, right? He was just left in a pitcher too long there. He got away from the lefty matchup. I think Farrell made a little blunder there. But it's early, right? And we're going to be saying that for probably the next month or so. It's early. Not worried, but the bullpen better get it together.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we dealt with it all last year, 25 yeah. blown saves.
Yeah.
We don't even want to approach the 20 number, I know that.
That's the rough part, is that, you know, this is like deja vu.
Yeah.
This is one of the main thing that we thought Anthopoulos fixed on the Jays. So to come out and see them struggling out of the gate, that's like a kick in the nuts.
Pretty much.
You know.
And I don't want to over-exaggerate. I know a lot of fans are getting a little bit out of control, thinking, you know, it's going to be the same thing all over.
Mm-hmm.
I've got confidence. I know AA really went to work on the bullpen, like you said.
Yeah.
He's brought in some strong veteran relievers. You know, the proof is pretty much in the pudding, as they say, because they've shown in their past how good they are, what they can do. You know, a little bit of a hiccup, I guess, to start the year, but that's okay.
Yeah, exactly. Let's get over it. Let's move on. You know, it's early in the season. I think the boys are going to get it together. They should. I mean, that's a great bullpen on paper, man.
Yeah, definitely. I'm looking forward to see how they react to the slow start.
Next up on Jay's Trending, center fielder Colby Rasmus.
So Rasmus has been pretty hot topic the last week and a half, I guess all season, really. Even the spring training. I mean, everyone's not quite sure what he's going to bring.
Yeah.
A lot of fans have been down on him. I think with the homestand, he's really started to flourish.
Mm-hmm.
He started out, he had a nice dive and grab in the home opener.
Yep.
Picked up a triple. I believe it was the next inning. It was his first at bat after the catch. So took some momentum over to the plate.
Yeah, crowd was behind him there. Beauty grab in center Saturday also.
Yep.
And, not quite a dive, but he really leaned out.
And made a nice play.
Yep.
And he's showing his defensive skills, which is the main reason he's there. I mean, he's batting the bottom of the order.
Yeah.
They moved him up ahead of JPA now because he's struggling. But I like what Rasmus is doing.
Yeah.
And I think that he's going to continue to improve.
I think so, too. And it's funny getting to know his personality. He's definitely a country boy, very simple in his interviews and just like how he talks even. Like, it's hard to kind of get a grasp on what he's all about. You might even think he's kind of a dick sometimes, but I think that's how he is. He seems like a country boy who's there to do work and play baseball. And I even heard somewhere he's not even too big on crowds and that sort of thing and interaction with fans. So we'll see how he comes around and see how he reacts when the fans really get behind him, because we know the rough time he had in St. Louis. So hopefully he comes here and keeps doing what he's doing and gets the fans behind him and hits the ball, dives all over the place and does what he knows he can do.
And maybe if he cracks a smile, the fans will warm up a little bit too. I know that's what irks a lot of people. He doesn't even smile after he makes those nice grabs, but I think I've seen a bit of one. So I think he's coming around.
Yeah.
And definitely, again, big things expected. So can't wait to see what he does.
And rounding out Jay's Trending, third baseman Brett Laurie.
Well, the question is he out of control? I mean, start the series, he went flying over the little retaining wall they have for the photographers, landed small of the back.
He went in hard.
Right on the edge there. It was pretty hard. It was pretty wild, but a little bit out of control. Late in the game, they had a huge lead. I think they only needed four more outs. Like, it wasn't really necessary.
Yeah, but that's no problem. I mean, he brings that. He goes 110% all the time. Like, we've learned that about him. I love it. I hate to see him doing that and not coming down with the ball or not being in a serious situation because he could have hurt himself. He went into the wall there hard.
He really did. And you think he would have caught the ball, but the fan actually got his hands on it.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure, I mean, it's hard to say, but he had his glove there, so it would have been nice.
And Saturday, the game we were at, he bases loaded. Batista at the plate. Batista had two strikes on him. There was two outs. Brett Laurie decided to steal home.
All I could do was go like this.
Yeah.
I could not believe my eyes. We're sitting right behind home plate.
Yeah.
We'd even discussed during the at-bat if he could potentially steal just because the pitcher was in the full windup. And all of a sudden, he takes off.
Yeah, it was, I mean, you know, I knew Butterfield wasn't in on it. I knew he just thought he could do it. I mean, there's so many good things about this and negative things, I think. The energy he brings, that confidence, number one, being such a young player. I think that those are two great things. And to have the confidence to try that in that situation, I think is good. But let's be honest, the timing still wasn't right.
No, and
you got your big bat at the plate. Yeah. I mean, it was a mistake.
That's right. I was going to say, I'm pretty sure Bautista was pretty pissed.
Yeah.
Even with two strikes, he's been struggling. But they'd already had a couple singles, a walk, and a double in the inning, I believe. The guy was only a couple pitches away from being knocked out of the game.
Yeah.
There's a lot of different factors, but
long inning, yeah.
Yeah, and he'll smarten up. Farrell talked to him.
Yeah.
I'm sure Butterfield talked to him.
Oh yeah.
I'm sure his dad gave him a couple words. So
he's young. He's young and. Let's be honest, he's young and cocky. I mean, I don't even mean that in a bad way, though. Like, don't get me wrong. He's got that swag.
Yeah, it's swag. You know? It's not too much, but sometimes opponents might think it is. But
exactly. But all that energy he brings, he's got to learn how to stay within himself but still bring all that energy. Brett Laurie, we love you. Settle down. Well, the Back in Blue crew was at the home opener. Wasn't that awesome, man?
It definitely was. It was a packed house. Lots of noise. Felt great. We went down, you and I, Brad, Andrew and Bammer was down there also.
Yep.
Met a bunch of fans. Went Gideon, Bubba's brothers.
Yeah, that was cool, man.
Seen Jay's Dome again. Yep. Sorry, I can't shout everyone. I can't remember them all right now. But it was cool.
Yeah,
met,
very cool.
Seen some people. And Jay's blew the game, unfortunately.
Yeah, blew the game, yeah.
Very frustrating.
Mm-hmm. I predicted that Boston was going to tie it up in the ninth, but sure enough, they tied it up. And then what did they do, three more on top of that?
Yeah, and when that happened, I felt like turning around and slapping you.
And I don't blame you, man. I shouldn't have said that shit.
You're definitely not.
Yeah.
And, you know, a little back karma, I guess. But
yeah.
Unfortunately, they haven't won when we've been there yet. We actually went to the Orioles game on Saturday also.
Yep.
That was pretty cool.
Fun.
We got invited down from Jay's Care.
Yeah, Jay's Care. That was awesome.
Fine folks there.
Yeah.
We got some pretty sweet seats behind home plate.
Yeah, that was beauty.
Can't believe we were behind home plate when Laurie tried to steal home.
Yeah, we were like, what? It's so close.
But it was pretty intense. Like, just the fact that you're at the game and we're right there and someone actually tries to steal home. That doesn't happen all the time.
No, that was cool.
So I think that's what I mean.
He scored. Oh, my God. But he didn't. So let's get over that quick.
Exactly. Something else that kind of irked me was the wave.
Yeah.
Like, I understand people like doing the wave, but I think there's a time and place. I don't think in the middle of a 12-pitch at-bat, with a crucial situation is the proper time.
Yeah, were the bases loaded too?
I couldn't see, so I don't know. I'm not going to lie. Like, Brad put it up right now. We had a picture. This is during the ninth pitch of the at-bat.
Yeah.
This is my view during the ninth pitch. Like, everyone's coming around, and the guy beside me, he's sitting like this. He's like, you know, it passes you, and it goes all the way around.
Oh, yeah.
Comes around, and then, you know, they're sitting there like, here it comes, right. They're waiting, and it's like, woo! Yeah, that was, yo, I cannot stand it.
It was ridiculous, and I swear that wave made it around about 14, 15 times. It was like, give it up already, man.
I'm boiling right now. Like, it got to me.
It's such a fun thing to have happen.
I love the wave, though. Like, that's a thing. I'm not against it at all, but let's
the wave, we love you, but calm down.
Exactly. Like, let's do time and place, people. You know, maybe when we got the big lead, like, I don't even know if they were doing it on Saturday's game after the Jays were up a bunch of runs there.
I don't know.
I mean, I did watch most on TV. I was a little busy.
Oh, Sunday.
Sunday. And so I don't know if they're doing it on Sunday, but even at the home opener, they were doing it on the very first pitch. I know it's a crazy crowd, but like, we really watch baseball.
Oh yeah, yeah. There's quite a few drunk people at that opener too. But yeah, that the wave can get, it's such a beautiful thing. But good Lord,
makes me shake my head. I know, it really does.
Yeah.
But what else happened this week? It was a good week. Well, I guess it was a good week to be a Blue Jay fan. We're above 500, but of course the blown saves.
Yeah.
Very frustrating.
Yeah, well, we went 3-3 this week against Boston and Baltimore, and we should be better. What are we, 5-4 now?
Yeah, definitely 5-4, and depending when you're watching this, of course.
Yeah.
But
there's no reason we shouldn't be quite a bit better than that, but it's early, man.
It is, and so let's do a quick recap of the players. I mean, KJ, I think he's the hottest bat right now.
Oh, yeah, man. What a pleasant surprise. And I was really looking forward to seeing him play. Swinging a great stick, man.
That's right. He's, I don't know his averages right now as of taping, but I know yesterday it was up in 370-something when we were there. And he's got a couple home runs, two of the last three games.
Some pop the other way, too. The ball's coming off his bat going out left center.
A couple extra base hits on top of that. Kelly Johnson, I said he's playing great, and he is this week's Blue Jay of the Week.
And now it's time for Nick's Blue Jay of the Week.
Kelly Johnson, time of Blue Jay of the Week. He had 6 hits, home run, 3 RBIs, looking real good. Since then, he makes me feel real good. He's got, like I said, he had 2 home runs in the 2 games following the Jay of the Week announcement.
Yeah, I think he might have found out. I think he heard from me. I better step my game up even more.
Pretty sure that's what happened. I almost guarantee it. But definitely great to see him playing well in front of Bautista.
Yep.
I know the last few weeks on the radio they've been discussing how the protection from Bautista isn't always behind him.
Yeah.
How a lot of the times the protection for your best hitter is in front of him because you got to be on base.
Exactly.
You can't leave him with the 2 outs all the time, right? So you got to have the guys on base. You got to have the, I guess I keep saying it, but like I said, the solid on-base percentage, whether you're getting hits or walks, you just need to be there.
Exactly.
And both Escobar and Kelly Johnson are those players.
Very good, yeah. Escobar's first few games or so, but he's been solid. And
that's right.
Kelly Johnson, man, amazing start.
Yeah, he's doing
so
great.
Happy.
Yep, and hopefully he's going to continue to put up the performance and he keep being the Blue Jay of the Week.
So, Nick, you had a chance to talk to Lloyd Moseby, former Blue Jay player, center fielder. Had a quick chat with him. Let's have a look at that.
Currently on the phone, I have a former Toronto Blue Jays center fielder who spent 10 years with the team. He was a second overall pick in the 1978 amateur draft, and he's the franchise's all-time leader in stolen bases. It's my pleasure to welcome Lloyd Moseby to the podcast. Lloyd, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Now, Lloyd, you're part of the outfield known as the Killer Bees, and currently the Blue Jays have their own Killer Bee in the form of Jose Bautista. What are your thoughts on Bautista and this year's young Blue Jays team?
I was tough to have a real response because I don't watch it every day, but from afar, I think Bautista definitely have put a lot of spark back into the city. There's no question about that.
Recently, I heard Jesse Barfield refer to you as the funniest person on earth. What was the clubhouse atmosphere like with players like Bell and Barfield and Kelly Gruber?
Oh man, I don't think you can duplicate that team. I mean, everybody was pretty much family. We considered ourselves family and friends, and to this day, we still have a tremendous friendship between one another. So it was always a blast to be in the clubhouse, especially with George Bell. What a different guy, but one of the greatest guys you ever meet in your life.
What exactly was it about George Bell?
He had the charisma. He had the attitude. He had all the things that make us laugh every day, and that's what you need when you're playing 162. No question about it.
Now, one of my favorite highlights on VHS is the time that you stole second base, you stole first base, and you stole second base all in the same play. What can you tell me about that play?
Well, I've got it on video right now, and I'm trying to sell it to the little league players. That way they can become a lot worse base runners. So, no, that was a blast. Come on now. That stuff kind of just happens. It wasn't, certainly, it didn't happen on purpose, but that was one of the things that the kids remind me of today. And it's not fair. You know, I think I'm going to sue Major League Baseball for that video. But as of right now, I'm going to let it go.
Yeah, it certainly was one of the funnier plays. Do you get back to Toronto very often?
Oh, yeah. No, I come to T.O. a lot, you know. I've been there this summer probably about 4 or 5 times. So I always consider Toronto home for me. I mean, that's where I was raised at. And so it's one of the greatest cities in the world. So that won't stop, believe me.
It's well known that your nickname was Shaker. Where exactly did that originate?
Well, that's basketball all the way. That Al Woods, which is a former player. He knew me as a young guy in high school, and that was my nickname from basketball. So Al Woods brought me into the clubhouse in the big league. So it never stopped from that point on.
Now, I recently spoke to Kelly Gruber, and he mentioned he's hoping to have you part of his baseball camps, and you're also part of the Blue Jays Honda Super Camps this summer. What can you tell us about the Super Camps, and how does it feel to give back to the game of baseball?
Oh, yeah, the camps are tremendous. I mean, we've seen so many good players in Canada right now. Again, I think the game has really changed with the Canadians. I mean, it used to be just hockey, but baseball is just tremendous now in the Vancouver area. We've been all over, actually, but Vancouver have a lot of good players there. So, giving back is what it's all about. And we wish we could have done it then, but again, back in the 80s, baseball wasn't as big, but somehow it just really exploded in the Canadian market right now, and I'm just happy to be a part of it.
Well, that about wraps it up. I want to thank Lloyd Moseby for joining the Back in Blue video podcast. It was my pleasure, and I look forward to speaking to you again in the future.
Anytime, bud. Give me a call anytime.
Special thanks to Lloyd Moseby for taking the time to talk to Nick. And that about does it for Back in Blue 15. Another one in the books.
It's crazy. 15. It's awesome.
Yep.
Can't complain. Thanks, everyone, for watching. I want to announce that we have a new blogger. He's going to be keeping an eye on the prospect situation @Andrew_Lutz. He's new part of the team, so welcome to the team. Big thanks to Jay's Care. We had lots of fun going down there, watching the game as always, taking it in person live.
Yeah,
it's pretty cool.
That was great. Met some kids. That was special, man, being up in that suite.
Yeah, we met Ace. Yeah. It was great. Got a big high five from him. Right, that was pretty cool.
Love it.
Yeah.
And also we want to mention, we talked with Frank Calinato on the Back in Blue 14, had a nice little interview with him. And I want to remind you that his book, Heart and Hustle, comes out April 16th. Mm-hmm. You can check that out. All details on his site at frankcalinato.com. That's Heart and Hustle. It sounds like it's going to be a good one.
It is. And actually, quick mention, if you order off his website, I believe he is autographing every book.
Beauty. Let's do it. Back in Blue 15 in the books. Bam! Back in Blue, baby.
Back in Blue is sponsored by Logicore, focus on the core, and Anjack Limited, your roofing and wall cladding specialists.